You are listening to the Hiking Radio Network, where we talk the walk with shows by hikers about hikers for everybody.
Welcome to the Trail Dames podcast, where we speak with women who love to dance upon this earth. So years ago, I was playing a gig with an Andean band. There were five men, and they were dressed in all these brilliant colors, and they were playing drums and pan flutes. And one of them stepped up to introduce his next song. And he said, "I stood out on the mountaintops of Peru, looking out over the Incan Trail, and I saw where the feet of my ancestors had walked centuries before." And it was just so romantic sounding and amazing. And that very statement led me to go on years later and hike the Inca Trail. Well, today's guest is my friend Melissa Zimmerman. And she took that one step further, no pun intended. She went to Peru. She had basically no real backpacking experience. It was her first international hiking trip. But she went and she did the 8-day Choquequirao Trail. It's a very intense, difficult trail that takes you through all kind of ruins in Peru that the only way you can see them is to actually do this hike. So join me as we talk to her and hear all about her adventures and the ups and downs, again, no pun intended, of the Choquequirao in Peru. My name is Anna, and my friends all call me Mudbutt, and today you're listening to the Trail Dames podcast. I'm gonna dance upon this earth. Hey, Melissa, good morning. Thank you so much for joining us on the podcast.
Thank you for having me.
I'm very excited that you're here because you actually went out and had a grand world adventure. And you did something that I had never heard of. So tell us what you did.
I hiked to Choquequirao, which is in Peru. It's called basically the little sister to Machu Picchu. It's grand house or estate, similar to Machu Picchu, but it is only accessed by hiking. You can't take the bus there.
So why did you pick this particular trail? And the reason I ask is because, you know, I've done the Inca Trail, and I know a lot of people that have done the Inca Trail, and that's kind of like famous, I guess. But I've never heard of this one. What made you decide to go this route?
Well, I'm kind of a fan of lists, like, you know, the best hamburger place in every state or the best place, you know, tourist traps in the world. And this was on a list of places you should go to see before they become overrun with tourists. And I knew from many people telling me that Machu Picchu is overrun with tourists. And I did go there as part of this trip. I just didn't hike there. And it is very full of tourists. But Choquequirao just feels like you're in it by yourself.
Oh, that's got to be really nice.
It is.
So now, had you ever actually hiked internationally before?
No, this was my first time.
Really?
Yeah.
So what kind of hiker would you call yourself? Are you like a long distance backpacker? Are you a day hiker that likes to see the flowers? What do you like?
I am more of a day hiker. This is a little beyond my comfort zone.
It sounds like it might have been a lot beyond your comfort zone.
Yeah, it was very difficult. I wish I had prepared more for it, but it is what it is. I made it through it, and that's what's important.
So was it difficult? In general?
Yes. I had not expected, and probably that's my own fault because I didn't do a lot of research. I wanted to be surprised to that when it said that the elevation for the day was going to be 4,000 feet down and 1,800 feet up, that it was actually going to be 4,000 feet down and then 1,800 feet up.
Right.
There's no flat. There's no little up and down, up and down, up and down like we're used to here in Georgia. No, it's all down and then all up.
So is this generally your nature? Like you said, you like to be surprised. Do you generally just kind of jump in and let the trail take you where it will?
Sometimes if I'm going with people that I can rely on to know that stuff, then I like to be surprised. I like to just be in the moment. And I was going with a tour group. So I knew that they were going to take care of me. And it was basically glamping. They took very good care of us. But if I had to plan my own hike and hike by myself, I'm a rigid planner.
Oh, are you really? Yes. Normally. Gotcha. So, because, you know, that's another whole podcast topic that we should do in the future sometimes. But this whole thing about having different planning styles, because I'm a very much of a jump in and just let the universe take me where it will kind of a girl. Mm-hmm. But I, you know, it's so fascinating to me that somebody would go completely to a foreign country and just, you know, get a plan and go, here I am, let's do this. And I love that about you. I think that's really cool.
My mom was even more like that because she was relying on me to relay her information. She really was surprised.
I think this is awesome. So tell me, when did you actually do this? What time of year was it?
It was late July to early August. It was a 2-week itinerary, and we did 10 days of camping on the trail and 5 days of hiking for distance.
So this is actually a quite a bit longer trek than for any of our listeners that want to go out and do the Inca Trail. That's usually a 4-day trek. So you were out there for 10?
Yeah. I mean, we camped at the beginning because it's far away from Cusco. And then we camped twice at the end as we made our way from the end point to the train to go up to Aguas Calientes, which is the jumping off point for Machu Picchu. So okay. Actually hike, you know, camping on the trail was more like 7 nights.
Gotcha. Okay. All right. So you flew into, what'd you do? Fly into Lima?
Flew into Lima and then took a smaller plane into Cusco.
And did you do any, personally, did you go to do any acclimatization, you know, to get used to the altitude, or did you just meet your group the next day and go?
Mom and I, because my mom went with me, flew in 3 days early so that we could have extra time to acclimatize because we both live very close to sea level at basically 1,000 feet. And neither of us had spent time at elevation beyond 6,000 feet. So we weren't really sure how we were going to respond to it. So we did have those 3 extra days, and the tour group itinerary built in 2 days in Cusco, which is at 10,000 feet.
So did you guys have any trouble with the altitude?
I could definitely feel it. Going up the 3 stairs to the hotel, it was like, oh, I'm winded already. This is not normal. But we were both on anti-altitude medication. Neither of us got any severe altitude sickness. We think that part of the reason why I didn't have any appetite for the first several days might have been caused by altitude, because we were told altitude can mess with the digestive system.
Right.
So I was basically eating because I knew I needed to the first 5 or 6 days I was there.
Oh, I mean, that's a long way. That's a long time to have no appetite when you're climbing those kind of ascents.
Right. So the first, well, we were there 5 days early. So the first day on the trail, I bonked like a third of the way down the trail. My legs are wobbly and I'm like, I don't know whether I should keep going. I don't know if I should quit. And the guy's like, you know, we'll get to take care of you. Just go your own pace. And I made it to the bottom. There may have been some tears. There definitely were some tears. And then at the bottom, I caved in. They had 2 emergency horses, which worked out great because mom was also very tired because it was 4,000 feet down the first day. And the horses can take us uphill, but they can't take us downhill. So when we got to the bottom, we both jumped on the horses and took them up.
That was probably a really smart move at that point.
Yeah, because I would not have made it up.
Right. Yeah. Yeah. A lot of people, if they're not hikers, I don't think they understand the idea that actually going down is, for me, so much harder. So much harder on the body. It's just awful. I'd rather go uphill all day long.
Oh, I'd rather go downhill all day long. So when I was like, would you really? 4,000 feet, I can do this. I probably would have done much better if I had the fuel in my system to burn, but I just ran out of energy. And, you know, I went through 3 liters of water before lunch, And because it was on the sunny side of the slope, they had organized it so that we were always going down the sunny sides and going up the shadier sides. So we were in the sun the whole time. On the sunny sides of the slopes, it's sandy and rocky, so you have to watch your step, every step. Otherwise, you'll slide and land on your butt.
Right.
Like I did. At least once. But, you know, that first day was a hard day for the whole tour group. One of the very experienced hikers that was in the group confessed later in the tour that she had puked that night when she got to the camp. And the guide that was staying with my mom and I, because we were the tail end, the slow people, he stopped on the way uphill while we were on the horses. And like, I can't go any further. I need to stop here. He had basically gotten dehydrated. He had ran out of water. So it was a tough, tough first day for everyone.
So tell me actually, so I know it was really difficult, but what does the trail look like? So that first day, what were you seeing when you looked out around you?
You're in the Andes. So you're seeing peaks, ridges. We basically hiked down into a river valley and hiked back up out. Over the course of the 5 days of hiking for distance, we hiked down into two different river valleys and hiked back out. So we went over four passes, I think. The first one was when we first started. We went over that pass. There's a pass at Choquequirao. There's a pass before you get to Unama. Okay, so three passes. And the sunny side is, you know, like I said, sandy and rocky and very barren. You're lucky if you find a tree big enough to give you any shade at all. And then the shadier side that we did uphill is what they call a cloud forest. It's got more trees. You can probably find shade 50% of the time, depending on the time of day. And it's usually a little bit cooler because they're putting off some moisture. So it feels cooler. It's evaporating. Whereas on the sunny side, it felt like you were in 80 degree heat, but it was very dry. And on the cooler side, on the shady side, it was probably felt like 50 to 60 degrees, depending on what elevation you were at. And we did hike to some higher elevations. The end pass that we went over was 13,000 feet. So that was very, very cool up there.
And did you carry a day pack?
Yeah, we carried a day pack. So my pack contained 3 liters of water, some snacks, rain gear, and a first aid kit, because I like to be prepared.
Of course.
And we had mules that carried, we had a big duffel bag that we could pack, and I didn't even pack it full. And then they provided all of the tents and cooking equipment and stuff.
Did any of your porters or guides speak English?
Not very well. So we had an American guide that was with us the entire 14-day trek or 14-day tour. While we were on the trek, we had a Peruvian guide who spoke fairly decent English, but you could tell it was the second language. And the two of them alternated between being at the head of the group and the back of the group. And then as far as our cook and prep cook, camp manager, and four, they call them arrieros, they take care of the mules and the horses, they spoke mostly Quechua, which is the local native language. And a few of them spoke Spanish, and almost none of them spoke English.
That's the way it was when I did the Inca Trail. And I got tickled because for 4 days, I communicated with all the porters through thumbs up and smile.
I speak very bad Spanish. So my Spanish was limited to, is everything okay? ¿Estás bien? Oh. Are we going to die now? So, yeah. I understand the hand gestures.
Yeah, if I ever go back and if I ever try this trail, that's what I'm going to learn the Quechuan for. Are we going to die now? For sure. So how many people were actually in your group?
You only had 4 people that paid to take the tour. So we had 9 people taking care of 4 people.
Wow. This is so great because, you know, for me, a place like that is so magical and special. And to have such a small group just sounds to me perfect.
It was great. And it worked out great because mom and I needed the horses to go uphill. We basically rode the horses uphill every time we could because I was so worried that I was going to have another terrible day like the first day that I just relied on the horses to carry me uphill. And mom was basically at the same kind of physical status as me, so she did the same. And the other two people in the group were used to elevation, they were used to hiking long distances, so they were just, you know, going at their own pace at the front of the group. So it worked out very well with just two of us, or four of us total.
I can remember when I hiked the Inca Trail, and two of the people in our group, which was a much larger group, were from Colorado. And like high up in Colorado, you know, and they would just kind of look at us with pity in their eyes and go, are you okay? And I'd be like, shut up, I'm from Georgia.
Yes, the lady in the group, she lives in Colorado, so she lives in elevation, and she did for a while search and rescue with her dog in the mountains in Colorado. Wow. So she is very used to it. And, you know, even she struggled that first day. So it was a very hard day. And, but, you know, they were able to go at their own pace and we weren't holding them back. So everyone was pretty happy.
Well, and I think this is, you know, to me, this is such the most important part of hiking well. And that is finding your pace, finding your way, you know what I mean? Not worrying about you have to do it a certain way. You know, if you could take your own pace and do it your own way, we can do anything in this world.
Right. Yes. And I wish I wouldn't have relied on the horses as much, because there were days where we'd still get to the camp at lunchtime. And if I had just walked more, we probably would have made it by dinner time. You know, it would have been a different experience.
Right. Right. I can understand that. But now tell me about, you know, hiking with your mom. So was your mom already a hiker also? Or because I know, because for those of you who don't know, Melissa, she and I met through a hiking club. So you have day hiking experience. What about your mom?
Not as much. She had to go out and buy her first backpack and hiking boots and stuff like that. She's a very outdoorsy woman. She lives on a farm, although she doesn't farm anymore. So she's used to hard work, and she goes kayaking on the river and getting ready for this. My brother and her went hiking at some of the parks in Iowa, but you know, Iowa's very flat. So she didn't really have the hills to get ready for. On Memorial Day weekend, I flew her down here to Georgia, and our plan was to hike Blood Mountain in Georgia, which, if anyone knows, is about 1,400 foot elevation change from the parking lot to the summit. We were going to try and do that twice. We did it about 1 1/3 times because I had developed serious blisters from not breaking in my hiking boots properly, and Mom was on the way to also getting some serious blisters. So we called it quits before we damaged ourselves. But we both felt that we could have done it twice.
So let me get this straight. So you convinced your mom, who was not a hiker, to go to a foreign country and hike one of the hardest trails in history.
Yes. And she also doesn't speak any Spanish. So she was relying on me to provide the interpretation.
Just for the record, I love your mom. She's so brave. That's awesome. Well, I think you're both rock stars. So when you went to Peru and told people that you were hiking the Choquequirao Trail, what was their response?
If you told people in Peru that you were doing Choquequirao, they're like, oh, yeah, they knew it was a very hard trail. They didn't look at the people that did the Inca Trail the same way that they looked at us after we told them, like, you guys are serious hikers.
Well, and I just, you know, I want to tell all of our listeners, the Inca Trail was 4 days long and was physically, I think, the most difficult thing I've ever done in my life by far. It is so hard. And so when I think about this trail, which sounds so much infinitely harder, you know, I just want to, like, I think y'all should wear t-shirts that say, like, I'm a rock star and I can prove it, you know, because I hiked the Choquequirao Trail. I think this is really amazing. I do think that for your mom, if you take her anywhere else now in the world and hike, she's going to be like, really? Is this it?
I was telling her, you know, we could go do the Camino de Santiago in Spain. And she's like, really? You know, I'm not so sure. You know, I have to research that a little bit more. I think I kind of scared her off with Peru being closed.
I think you guys should do it. And I think you should do a mother-daughter blog or podcast while you're doing it. So let's go back to this hike for just a second. So, because I want to ask you, did you have any moments where you really just wanted to quit and go home and you were like, done?
Oh, yes. That first day, about 1/3 of the way down the trail, I was so ready to quit because we were a third of the way down, which still meant we still had to go up. And I had to go another third of the trail to get to lunch and another third of the trail to get to the bottom. And, you know, we stopped at, they had built a shade structure at this third way point, and there was a seat. And I was just so over everything at that point. I wanted to stop and drink some water, although I had been drinking water along the way. I wanted to try and eat something, even though it tasted like sand in my mouth. I wanted to put on sunscreen, and I wanted to put on bug spray. And by the time I got to bug spray, my entire left arm was bitten up by these sand flies, which at the time, they didn't hurt and they didn't itch. They just looked like terrible red welts. But 2 days later is when they started itching, and they itched for the rest of the hike. So, but that point, I was like, I don't know if I can do this. I mean, is it better to turn around and leave right now or keep going? And the guide convinced me to keep going, that, you know, they would take care of me. They had the emergency horses. You know, if something happened, they would take care of it. And I pushed through, got through it. And it really took me until we got to Choquequirao and we had that quote unquote rest day, which really wasn't a rest day, because Choquequirao itself, you have to hike around it to see it, to really kind of relax and be like, okay, I'm here. I can enjoy it. You know, they're going to take care of me. They got me here. This is where I wanted to be. I get to see everything. And then at that point, I really started to enjoy the rest of the hike. But getting there was very strenuous. And I didn't really necessarily want to quit so much after the first day, but it was still kind of like, I probably shouldn't be doing this. You know, I definitely wasn't ready. Why didn't I exercise more? Those kinds of thoughts kept rolling through my head.
Right. It's that little voice in our head that I once heard a marathon runner say, it is not your friend.
Definitely not your friend.
Not our friend. So, and this is what really kind of fascinates me and moves me when I hear stories like this and that. And that's the mental game of it, because I understand that the guide helped to talk you kind of down off the ledge, so to speak.
Right.
But mentally, like, what did you tell yourself? How did you get yourself to just keep going?
I was like, if I can get to the bottom, I can get to the horses, and then everything will be fine. So at one point I put in headphones. I'm like, I just got to get out of my headspace. You know, I was sucking on some lemon candy to try and just have something in my mouth for a little bit of calories. I was like, you know, if I leave right now, I'm going to have to pay for like 10 days of hotel rooms, which were really expensive. If you wanted to stay in a nice place and not a hostel, until I get to take the train to Machu Picchu. And that would just be a big pain in the butt and a lot of expenses. So I'm like, I don't want to do that. I'm going to just stay here. I'm going to do this. And that's how I eventually got down the mountain to where I could get to the horses.
Did you feel responsible for your mom's enjoyment of the trail or success, quote unquote, on the trail? Or like, had you left, would your mom have stayed and kept hiking, or would she have gone with you?
That was another big question, because I didn't want to ruin her trip too. And she was like, let's keep going. So I kept going also partly because of her. So yeah, that had a factor into it as well.
Did you have any moments on the trail where you actually felt amazing? Any of those, oh my God, look where I am moments?
Yeah. So when we got to Choquequirao, That was the moment that was like, I am here, you know? And I remembered you told the story of one of the more strenuous hikes that you went on your first time, and how you got to the top and you just like raised your arms and danced. And so when I got to the top of Choquequirao, I wanted to collapse, but I raised my arms. I was like, I am here.
Oh, and that makes me so happy, because I want everyone to celebrate when they, you know, when they accomplish something like that. I think the celebration is kind of the best part, you know?
Yeah. And it was, I was like, I made it to the top. It was one of the first days where I couldn't ride the horse going uphill. So I had to do it all myself. And it took a while to get up there. One of the guides was like, okay, we'll leave early. We'll leave an hour before the other group that's faster than us. And we'll just start hiking at our own pace. You know, we don't have to rush, and we'll just get there and we'll be fine. And having a guide with that mentality And he was actually keeping us going slower when we were hiking. And so that helped. I attended the Trail Game Summit last summer, and I remember sitting in on a presentation, and the lady was like, when you're going uphill, you have to go slow. You know, you should be able to go like 200 steps before you stop. And I tried to implement that here in Georgia and on other hikes, and I just didn't understand it. I was like, it feels like I can just go my own pace and stop when I need to stop. And it's much faster than trying to go without stopping. But I got it when I was at elevation. I was like, this makes so much more sense to take very slow steps, and I can actually not have to stop every 10 steps. Instead, I can stop every 200 steps. So we did that to get to the top of Choquequirao, and it was amazing. And the view was gorgeous. And like I said, Choquequirao is so isolated that we basically had it all to ourselves, except one person is sitting in the middle of the plaza, just reclined in all of our photos of the plaza. So we didn't quite have it all to ourselves.
So did that one person get there by hiking also?
We think that he was actually one of the park managers.
Oh.
So at Choquequirao, they have a couple of different guides that basically take care of the park and make sure people don't break it and follow the rules.
Right. Well, you know, I find this really fascinating and cool because I did a podcast a while back on going uphill. Mm-hmm. And I talk about how, like you, I learned truly how to go uphill in Peru. And I had been told many times how to do it and people tried to teach me, but it didn't all really click into place until I was hiking in Peru. And you learn that those ascents, they're only going to happen if you really do slow down.
Yeah, going at what my normal pace would have been, it would have taken twice as long, if not three times as long, because I would have had to stop and pant and breathe for 5 minutes to catch my breath every 10 steps. That's how hard the elevation hit me.
Well, that elevation, it is not for the faint of heart. You know, I personally was pretty lucky. I think that I responded to it like you did. I definitely felt it, but I didn't have big troubles. But when I hiked in Peru, people around me were throwing up and we got really sick. I had a great, great friend who wasn't even able to do the hike because she got pulmonary edema from it. So it's definitely, this is just not a walk in the park, you know?
No, it's not.
All right. So if somebody is listening to this and they say, oh, I would love to do something like that, but that's not for me, I'm not brave like that, what would you tell them? I mean, do you think anybody can attempt this?
No, I don't think anybody could attempt this because it's so hard. But if you are able to go on day hikes like me, you can definitely do it. It will be hard. It will be very hard, but it will be so worth it. You will get to see things that most people that go to Peru never see because it is only for the people that want to hike and see it. And Choquequirao wasn't even the only stop on that trip. We also got to see other sets of ruins along that route. But if you want to do it, if you're ready, willing to put in the work ahead of time, if you pick a good tour group that has emergency horses to act as your backup plan, that is definitely an option.
You know, in Trail Days, we have a bumper sticker that says the best views are the ones that you earn. Mm-hmm. And that's what I think of. I think of, you know, anybody can, you know, take a bus to a beautiful place and see it. And that's wonderful if that's your style. But there are these places in the world that if you want to get there, you got to put in the work and go there yourself and on your own two feet. And I just love that. I love the idea that the only people that get to see those places are the ones that worked for it.
Yes. And you don't even have to go with a tour group. Like if you're an extreme adventurer, you don't need a permit for this trail. And there you can backpack it yourself. There, we ran into two or three different groups of backpackers that did it themselves. They carried all their stuff the whole way. And those people are truly superhuman because, like, I was carrying a day pack and they were carrying 5 days worth of stuff on their back. And they're still making the trip.
I can't even imagine. What are the water sources like? I mean, did you have enough water sources?
Yes. So there are places to stop and camp that are about even less than a day hike apart, where you can get water. And they're, you know, glacial springs or the river if you're at the bottom of the valley, where you can fill up. You do still need to treat it just like, you know, all the water in Peru. You're not supposed to drink it unless you want to play with whether you're going to get a stomach bug. So you either have to boil it or filter it or treat it with chemical treatment. But they're there. The biggest issue that people ran into is some of them, well, so you can do the hike two ways. You can hike to Choquequirao and hike back out the same way you came, which is a much shorter trip. Or you can hike to Choquequirao and continue on to Yanama, which is the next town that has an actual road built into it, which is a longer trip. And the biggest thing that we knew of people running into is they would get to Choquequirao's campground and they'd be like, okay, well, where do we buy food? And the guide that was with us was like, well, you needed to buy food like 4 hours ago down the trail. That was the last place that sells food. And there was even a family that showed up at the campground and was like, okay, well, where do we get a tent for the night? And the guide was like, well, you had to bring it yourself. You know, so the information about this trail is difficult to find. So people showed up unprepared, and that was kind of sad to see. And I was like, oh, thank goodness I planned this with the tour group that knows what they're doing, because I would have been so upset if I had, you know, hiked here and didn't have any food.
Yeah, I can't even imagine. You know, I had kind of assumed that you were required to go with a guide. And so I didn't realize you could go by yourself. I'm really glad y'all went with a guide. That's the point. Yes. I, you know, on a lot of times on international hikes, I mean, I'm all for hiking solo and all that. That's great. But when you're in a foreign country, and like you said, especially if a trail doesn't have much information out there, going with a guide is just kind of a smart move. That support is fantastic.
Yeah.
So do you have any kind of plans for adventures in the future?
I think I'm going to take it easy for a little bit.
You're still tired, aren't you?
I am.
From the Choquequirao Trail.
I definitely want to do more hiking in the Georgia Mountains, North Georgia Mountains. I love hiking with the trail dames. It's just been super busy with work lately that I haven't gotten to do that. As far as the next big destination hike, I am seriously thinking about the Santiago de Camino in Spain. I think I need to brush up on my Spanish a little bit more, but, you know, have a couple of years to do that before I actually go to Spain, I think.
Well, I'm always been a big person for planning my adventures 2 and 3 years out. So, but you know, the secret, the difference between a dream and a reality is setting a date. So, yes. You know, set your date for 2021 or 2022 and go for it, because then you could come back on the Trail Names podcast and tell us about that adventure.
Hopefully it'll be a little less exciting than this one was.
I think it'll be different, but I think it'll be amazing nonetheless. So, all right. Well, look, I want you to, when we hang up, I want you to go hug your mom and tell her that I think she's a total rock star. I already thought you were a rock star, so I guess I shouldn't be surprised. And for our listeners, I'm going to put what information I can find about this trail in the podcast notes and some photos so that you can see what Melissa did, what her adventure looked like. And if you have any questions about it, you can email us at info@traildames.com, or you go to the Trail Dames podcast Facebook page. I will make sure Melissa gets all your questions and answers them. And Melissa, I just cannot even tell you how much I appreciate you coming and sharing this adventure with us, because it's one I had never heard of. I bet most of our listeners haven't heard of it. And now I'm totally inspired to go do it myself.
Good. Thank you.
Well, thank you so much. I hope you have a great rest of your day.
Thanks, you too. I'm gonna dance
upon this earth. Oh, wasn't that awesome? You know, I have to tell you guys that, you know, I've always been really proud of my own personal Inca Trail hike, but listening to her, I felt kind of jealous and like, or not jealous, but envious, because this trek sounds amazing. I'm not sure I physically could do it, but it just sounds beautiful and intense. And I love, love, love the idea of seeing all those places that the only way you can see them is to walk to them. Actually, climb mountains to get to them. I just appreciate Melissa so much sharing her story with us. And actually, if you remember, she mentioned that she had been to the Trail Dame Summit. If you're interested in that, we actually are having a summit in 2020. Our summit is a 3-day, 2-night women's hiking and backpacking conference. It happens in North Carolina, and it's full of special guest speakers, clinics, classes about everything you could possibly want to know about hiking and backpacking. You can find more information about that at thetraildamesummit.com. Thank you so much for listening to today's podcast. And now hang out, and I'll share a couple of journal entries from my own Appalachian Trail through hike. Again, my name is Anna. My friends all call me Mudbutt, and you're listening to the Trail Dames podcast. Now go hike.
I'm gonna dance upon this earth.
June 12th. Woohoo! I am headed to town. I am so excited. Don't get me wrong. I'm certainly feeling all accomplished and all. I am woman, hear me roar. I mean, I am a backpacking rock star, in case you didn't know. I did solo miles. I not only hiked them, but I thrived while doing it. But honestly, what am I really feeling right now? I need a shower. I'm feeling a shower. I'm feeling some laundry, a hot meal that doesn't involve ramen, and a bed. Well, this morning, I got up and I ate, and I packed quickly with a distinct skip in my step. I feel like I could leap tall buildings, and I just knew that my legs were going to eat up the miles between me and town. Well, the reality is a little more, well, real. I made pretty good time, and I had a fairly uneventful hike until I started that long downhill to the highway. I don't know if it rained and I missed it, or if the tree cover kept the trail from drying off from all those storms we had earlier in the week, but slowly and surely, the trail got muddier and muddier and muddier. I hopped from side to side on the trail, doing my best to keep my boots fairly clean, but the sound of the mud trying to suck them off my feet got louder and louder, and the trail got steeper and steeper. All of a sudden, I had one of those moments, an out-of-the-body kind of moment where one minute I was looking at my boots, trying not to slip, and the next I was looking at the sky. Yep, I was looking straight up at the sky, from my back, flat on the ground. I don't know how, but both feet went out from underneath me at the exact same time, and there I was. Have you ever fallen over backwards wearing a 28-pound pack? You have to kind of imagine a turtle on its back. It's not particularly graceful, but it is very, very funny. I lay there and I just started giggling, and it got even funnier when I tried to get up. I couldn't turn over, like literally I was a turtle stuck on my back, and all the wriggling just dug me into the mud deeper. I was full out belly laughing by the time I managed to get turned over onto my hands and knees and push myself back up. And I was covered in black, slimy mud. And frankly, it had worked its way into places that, well, let's just say mud does not belong. I was kind of glad that there was no one around to see it. But as I started picking my way down the trail again, little fountains of laughter kept bursting out of my mouth. Thank goodness I'm headed into town and a shower and some laundry. It wasn't long before the sounds of traffic reached me and I popped out of the woods onto the side of the road. And would you believe it? There was a Dairy Queen right on the side of the highway, just calling my name. I figured that an Oreo blizzard was exactly what I needed to celebrate the fact that after all, my foot is held, my hiking partner is somewhere near here, and I am officially a thru-hiker again. So I walked into the Dairy Queen, and when I approached the counter, the little girl behind it looked up, and she looked horrified. It was then that I remembered that due to my earlier trail debacle, I probably looked a lot like the creature from the Black Lagoon. I just smiled at her and said, "Don't worry, it's just mud." She took my damp dollar bills with the very tips of her fingers, and she looked very, very relieved when I took my blizzard outside to sit on the curb. Sitting there, eating my ice cream with big clumps of drying mud falling off of my legs, I just couldn't be happier. Love, Mudbutt. June 13th. Did you ever have one of those days when your plans change like every 5 minutes? Well, this was one of those days. Bumpkin is finally here. Woohoo! Also, Knickknick, our AT friend who is also calling herself MG, she came to town and she graciously offered to support our hike in any way possible. So when someone quote-unquote supports a hike, it means that they slack pack the hikers when it's possible, or they meet us at road crossings so we don't have to carry as much food. It is really a godsend, and as far as I'm concerned, MG is just wonderful. So we started this morning out with a 3-mile hike to make up a little section that we had cut off to get into town and then to get a little past town. So the thought was that we would slack pack that part, do it without carrying our packs, and then come back and check out of the motel and continue on. Well, MG dropped us off and went to the northern end. She hiked towards us. We met up and exchanged keys. And then we went to go get her and we were done. It worked like a charm. The 3 miles flew by and they were fairly uneventful. One of the cool things, though, is that here in Parisburg, the Appalachian Trail crosses a long bridge on the highway. So instead of woods and flowers and mosquitoes, you have cars barreling by at about 55 miles an hour and a river rolling far below. The town went to a lot of trouble to block us off a pathway out of the traffic. So it's not dangerous or anything. It's just noisy. I thought it was kind of neat, though. Just one more Appalachian Trail experience. When we all met back up, we agreed that the Pizza Hut buffet was calling us. So off we went to fuel up before doing another 7 miles or so. Well, Mother Nature had other plans. So we got to the Pizza Hut and it started to rain so hard that frankly, I kind of expected to see Noah's Ark float by. We decided that maybe we should go to Blacksburg instead, to the Outfitters. Can you tell that we were having some motivation problems? I have to tell you, though, it was really raining. Well, after an afternoon of bumming around this cute little town, the sun did start to come out, and we decided to let fate decide our destination for the evening. Heads, we were going to have a hotel, warm shower, and TV. Tails, we were going to hit the trail for a couple of miles before dark. Well, we flipped that coin and tails it was. So MG dropped us off where we had ended our hike this morning and agreed to meet us in 2 days with the rest of our food. Did I mention that she's just awesome? The difference in carrying 2 days worth of food and 5 days is substantial, so we really did appreciate it. Did I also mention that when you leave Parisburg, you have about an 1,800-foot climb? We literally went uphill, steeply, for about 2 hours. Did you know that if the terrain is steep enough, you can almost get your toes to touch the front of your shins? My calves are not that flexible, and I'm sure that I'm going to pay for this tomorrow. Well, near the end of the hike, we had to cross several boulder fields, which were wet and slippery. These take all of my concentration, and they make me breathe just as hard as the uphills. Let's see, 2 straight hours with my heart rate in the 80 to 85% range. Yeah, I'm pretty much thinking I worked off that pizza buffet. Well, the sun was starting to go down when I turned a corner and there was Bumpkin building a fire at our campsite. Ah, home sweet home. After a quick dinner of mac and cheese, you gotta love those high sodium processed foods, I retired to my tent for the night. As I lay here typing, something's trying to get into my tent. It sounds like a mouse or a chipmunk or something. So maybe rubbing my feet with Tiger Balm wasn't such a great idea? Do mice like wintergreen? Oh well, at least whatever it is, it's small. It's not a bear. I'm just going to live and let live. Tomorrow, we finish our climb to the top of the ridge, and then it's a 17-mile ridge walk. Now that is the life. Just a quick footnote. So Silver Lining, our hiking friend, she defended her dissertation today, and that was the last step towards getting her PhD. So really, at this point, she should be Dr. Silver Lining. Congrats to her. And one more footnote. As the sun went down this evening, I looked over to see Bumpkin washing out her cooking pot and taking care of camp chores. And it hit me. I'm just so glad she's here. I told her that we were destined to hike this together, and now things are as they should be. Welcome back to my Bible-toting granny. Love, Mudbutt.